My name is Dr. Mahnoor Amin, PNMDP RTR, and I will be hosting today's session on acute severe hypertension, which is to be given by the respected Dr. Sabita Khatri. She is assistant professor of pediatric nephrology at SIUT and a consultant member of PNMDP as well. Madam, thank you very much for your time today. Before we formally start with the lecture by ma'am, we will go ahead with a brief introduction of PNMDP. So, PNMDP, who are we? We are Pediatric and Neonatology Developmental Program of Pakistan. Our mission is based on the saying of Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who says that when a person dies, his deeds are cut off except for three: continuing charity, knowledge that others benefited from, and a righteous son who supplicates for him. So basically, we are focusing on the aspect of knowledge that others benefited from. This is, I'll emphasize that this has been founded by Dr. Ayaz, and this is solely based on as a volunteer work, and this is his motivation, and all the team that has joined him is focusing on this thing. Our aim is to improve mortality and morbidity. So this is our team with Dr. Ayaz leading this. We have board members as shown in the list. We are thankful to all these people making the mission possible. So we have a YouTube channel. You can just type in PNMDP. I will post the link in the our chat box as well. There are many at-a-glance videos and many sessions they are put up there as well. These are our upcoming sessions, including today, four more to go. So you can join us as a member. The requirements are just, you have to be FCPS in pediatrics. You're happy to work voluntarily. And if you're enthusiastic and believe in teamwork, please join us. The contact is available written here. As you know, our website is in the final stage of development. This is how it looks. You can contribute us here. Just send anything, short, long case, an interesting case or blog section. Just send us on pnmdpp@gmail.com. For regional RTR, you can apply on the form. I can put up this as well on the chat box. So in a nutshell, I won't be taking much time. We'll be going to the presentation. PNMDP is for promoting quality education in child health. So we'll move towards our session, management of acute hypertension in children. Ma'am, I'll hand over the screen to you to begin with. Dr. Sabita.
Yes, ma'am, I'm here.
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Would you have to allow me to share my slides?
Just a minute. Are you able to do it now?
No. Yes, ma'am. Is my screen visible now?
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Okay. Should we start?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. First of all, thank you, Dr. Mahnoor and the PNMDP team for giving me the opportunity to share my knowledge through this platform. Assalamu alaikum and good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Sabita Khatri and I work as an assistant professor at SIUT. For the next 30 to 40 minutes, we will be discussing about acute severe hypertension by discussing different cases. I hope at the end of today's talk, we will be able to fulfill our objectives like how to define hypertension according to the clinical practice guidelines, causes and the pathophysiology behind hypertension, evaluation and management strategy of hypertension. Before proceeding further, I would like to discuss certain updates by American Academy of Pediatric Clinical Practice Guidelines. There are now new normative and screening table for BP, which I will be discussing in the subsequent slides. Moreover, they have specifically highlighted the importance of ambulatory blood pressure monitoring in diagnosis and management of hypertension. The term pre-hypertension is replaced with elevated blood pressure. Echocardiography should be performed prior to the pharmacological therapy. And finally, hypertensive crisis is replaced with acute severe hypertension. This table shows newer categories of hypertension in children recommended by the American Academy of Pediatrics. In next slide, I will explain these percentiles with example. While the BP cutoff for adolescent more than 13 years old are same as in adult guidelines. This is the new normative blood pressure table, which includes only children with normal weight and not obese and overweight children as used to be in earlier guidelines. These measurements are done through oscillatory method. This table omitted the 99th percentile. In order to make it clear to all of you, I have simplified this table. So consider if a child is 8 years old and falls on 10th percentile of height, his normal blood pressure should be less than 107, which is below the 90th percentile. And while elevated blood pressure should be in the range of 107 by 107 to 111. And in respect to stage 1 hypertension, blood pressure should be between 111 to 123, which is above the 90th percentile, which is above the 90th and below the 95th plus 12 mmHg. While the stage 2 hypertension is above, blood pressure should be above the 123. अगर हम इसको वापस से सिंप्लीफाई करें तो अगर 8 साल का कोई बच्चा है मेरे पास और वो फॉल कर रहा है 10th परसेंटाइल पे तो उसका नॉर्मल ब्लड प्रेशर कितना होना चाहिए शुड बी लेस देन 90th परसेंटाइल तो वो 107 होगा और अगर मैं उसको कहूं कि वो एलिवेटेड ब्लड प्रेशर में फॉल कर रहा है तो वो होगा बिटवीन 90th एंड 95th के दरमियान तो 107 और 111 और अगर मैं कहूं कि वो अगर आ रहा है स्टेजिंग के अकॉर्डिंगली तो उसकी स्टेज मोर देन 95th होगी बट लेस देन 95th प्लस 12 mmHg तो वो होगा 111 to 123 और जो stage 2 hypertension है वो more than 123 होगा. We have another table which is basically a screening table as it provides cutoff values for children from age 1 to 13 for further monitoring. Now I would like to present certain cases. With the help of these cases, I will be covering the objectives of today's presentation. Let's begin with our case number one. An 8-year-old boy, well-grown for age, presented with seizures and altered level of consciousness for one day. He had history of sore throat, followed by oliguria, cola-colored urine, and facial puffiness. On examination, his blood pressure was found to be 160 over 110 with mild edema. His GCS was 10 by 15 with the signs of upper motor neuron lesions. Pupils were bilaterally equal and reactive to light. Now we will answer following questions. And number one is, how would you classify his hypertension? As per traditional classification, this child falls under the category of hypertensive emergency, which is defined as the presence of end organ damage along with severe hypertension. As I've already mentioned, according to the latest guideline, the term hypertensive crisis is replaced by the terminology of acute severe hypertension, and which is defined as an acute episode of severely elevated BP with potential for end organ damage, often exceeding the limit for stage 2 hypertension. It is basically a clinical diagnosis which should be suspected in any patient with blood pressure at or above the limits of stage 2 hypertension. Risk of end organ damage increases as blood pressure is increased beyond 95th plus 30 mmHg of mercury. Now let's discuss another question, which is regarding the etiology of hypertension. In terms of the above presented case, the most likely etiology of hypertension is glomerulonephritis. Apart from the renal causes, there are other causes of hypertension too, which could be cardiovascular, malignancies, endocrine, neurological, monogenic, which I will be discussing in my subsequent slides. Furthermore, there are certain medications which are associated with the hypertension, and the least common etiology among children is primary hypertension. Now leading to our next question, which is about the pathophysiology behind this hypertension. Whenever there is decrease in GFR, there's increased absorption of salt and water, which leads to the expansion of extracellular volume and resulting in the decreased release of renin and aldosterone. And now we will discuss the management of his raised blood pressure. But prior to this, certain questions come in the mind of every pediatrician while managing acute severe hypertension. For instance, what should be the route of administration for the antihypertensive drug? Which drug should be used? How quick blood pressure should be lowered? And what should be the treatment blood pressure targets? Now let's find out these questions. In case of acute severe hypertension with the target organ damage, admit a child in PICU, immediately start IV antihypertensive therapy with vigilant blood pressure monitoring. We have to reduce the blood pressure gradually about 25% of the initial value in the first 6 hours. And then we have to reduce the blood pressure to the 95th percentile for the age over 48 hours. And now there would be two scenarios. Number one, if the blood pressure stabilizes after 48 hours, switch to oral therapy and transfer to pediatric unit. And if blood pressure is still unstable after 48 hours, then continue vigilant blood pressure monitoring and IV antihypertensive therapy. This table shows the drugs which are commonly used parenterally for the management of acute severe hypertension, but among them, drugs are labetalol, hydralazine, and sodium nitroprusside. But so far, we haven't used vasodilator sodium nitroprusside in our setup, and we do not have any experience of using sodium nitroprusside. As at this point, we are done with the questions related to case number one. Now, summarizing this case, the child has acute severe hypertension with the target organ damage. He has acute glomerulonephritis and hypertension, which was due to volume overload. Regarding his management, the child presented at stage 2 hypertension with blood pressure of 160 over 110 along with target organ damage. Our goal is to reduce the blood pressure at 95th percentile over 48 hours, which is 112 over 73. Thus, we reduce blood pressure by 48 mmHg, as the difference between 160 and 112 is 48. This target is fulfilled in two steps. In initial first 6 hours, reduce the 25% of 48, which is 12 mmHg, while over the next 48 hours, reduce the remaining 75% of 48 mmHg, that is 36 mmHg. जैसे कि हमारे पास ये बच्चा आया था तो उसका ब्लड प्रेशर 160 बाय 110 था, हमें उसको 20 हमें ओवर 24 टू 48 आवर्स में 95th परसेंटाइल पे लाना है. तो 95th परसेंटाइल सबसे पहले हमें देखना होगा किसका कितना बनता है, जो कि इस सेटअप में बन रहा है 112 बाय 73. अब हमें निकालना है कि इसका जो है हमारी जो टोटल रिडक्शन जो हमें करनी है वो हमें 25% जो करनी है वो करनी है हमें फर्स्ट 6 आवर्स में. तो 48 का अगर हम 25% निकाल रहे हैं तो वो 12 mmHg बन रहा है. तो हमें जो फर्स्ट 6 आवर्स में है वो हमें 12 mmHg ड्रॉप करना है, और जो रिमेनिंग 75% है जो 48 का है वो हमें रिमेनिंग नेक्स्ट जो है ना 48 आवर्स में करेक्ट करना है. तो इसको हमें स्लोली और ग्रेजुअली करेक्ट करना है, कोई रैपिड करेक्शन नहीं करनी, अदरवाइज साइड इफेक्ट्स होंगे और कॉम्प्लिकेशन हमें फेस करनी होंगी. सिंस वी आर डन विद केस नंबर 1, लेट्स मूव फॉरवर्ड टू केस नंबर 2. 10 years गर्ल विजिटेड लोकल प्रैक्टिशनर फॉर इंटरमिटेंट हेडेक. शी वॉज फाउंड to be hypertensive. Her blood pressure was 145/100 mmHg, which is more than stage 2, and BMR is 22. Her initial workup showed normal renal functions with insignificant urine analysis. Her renal Doppler studies were suggestive of right renal artery stenosis. Here we will be discussing each question in detail as we did in the case number 1. First of all, how will you categorize the hypertension? As we have learned previously about categorization of hypertension, keeping that in mind, our child falls in acute severe hypertension without target organ damage, as she doesn't have any signs of target organ damage. Question 2 is related to the mechanism leading to renovascular hypertension. This figure shows the pathophysiology of the renovascular hypertension. When stenosis occurs in the main or segmental renal artery, hypoperfusion of the justa glomerular apparatus leads to the release of renin, resulting in conversion of angiotensinogen to angiotensin 1, which is cleaved by angiotensin converting enzyme to angiotensin 2. Angiotensin 2 causes efferent arterial vasoconstriction, leading to glomerular hyperfiltration. Pressure neutralizes by the intact contralateral kidney, preventing volume expansion and sodium retention. In this way, the contralateral kidney prevents the raised blood pressure, reduce perfusion by reducing perfusion of affected kidney, resulting in continuous release of renin. मतलब जब भी कभी रीनल आर्टरी स्टीनोसिस हो रहा है, वेदर वो मेन आर्टरी में हो रहा है या ब्रांच में हो रहा है, तो हाइपोपरफ्यूजन हो रही है जस्टा ग्लोमेरुलर एपरेटस की, वहां से रेनिन रिलीज हो रहा है, रेनिन एंजियोटेंसिनोजिन को कन्वर्ट कर रहा है एंजियोटेंसिन 1 में, एंजियोटेंसिन कन्वर्टिंग एंजाइम इसको क्लीव कर रहा है एंजियोटेंसिन 2 में, एंजियोटेंसिन 2 क्या है वो हमारे इफरेंट जो आर्टेरियोल्स है उसको कंस्ट्रिक्ट कर रहा है, तो उससे हमारा जो है ना ग्लोमेरुलर हाइपरफिल्ट्रेशन बढ़ रही है क्योंकि वो हमारे इंट्राग्लोमेरुलर प्रेशर को इंक्रीज कर रहा है, और साथ में प्रेशर नेट्रोरेसिस हो रही है अपोजिट किडनी की. इसी तरीके से जो कंट्रालेटरल किडनी है वो ब्लड प्रेशर को जो है ना होने से वॉल्यूम को बढ़ने से रोक रही है, और सिमिलरली होगा क्या कि हाइपोपरफ्यूजन परसिस्ट रहेगी जो अफेक्टेड किडनीज है, और इसी तरीके से रेनिन रिलीज रहता रहेगा और ये साइकिल कंटिन्यू रहेगा. और नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज व्हाट आर द कॉजेज ऑफ रीनोवास्कुलर हाइपरटेंशन. This table shows the different causes of renovascular hypertension, which includes syndromes, neurofibromatosis type 1, Alagille syndrome, Williams syndrome, inflammatory acquired conditions are Takayasu's arthritis, Kawasaki. Renovascular hypertension occurs when there is the compression by externally compression, like neuroblastoma, Williams tumor. And the causes of renovascular hypertension in neonates are renal artery thrombosis, renal vein thrombosis, mid-aortic syndrome, congenital rubella. In certain cases, in some times, we do not find any cause of renovascular hypertension. And the term used for the renovascular hypertension, renal artery stenosis, where the etiology is not known, is idiopathic renal artery stenosis. And now finally, we will be discussing the investigation of choice and the management of renovascular hypertension. Apart from ultrasound Doppler, CT or MR angiography is also considered a screening investigation for renal artery stenosis. This picture shows the CT angiogram in which there is a narrowing at the ostium of right renal artery. But the gold standard investigation to confirm the renal artery stenosis is the digital subtraction angiogram. Here we can appreciate the stenosis of the right renal artery at the middle point, and here in bilateral renal arteries are stenosed. Digital subtraction angiogram is an invasive procedure, and therapeutic intervention can be done simultaneously once the stenosis is confirmed. Moving forward to the management of acute severe hypertension without target organ damage, we will skip this arm of the algorithm. And if the child has acute severe hypertension without target organ damage and he's able to tolerate orally, then start oral medications. If he's not able to take orally, then start IV infusion or bolus. Target of blood pressure reduction is to reach the 95th percentile in 24 to 48 hours. And we have applied the same, we have to apply the same rule, which we have done for acute severe hypertension with end organ damage. In first 6 hours, we have to reduce blood pressure only by the 25% of targeted. The remaining in the next for 24 to 48 hours to reach the 95th percentile. And over 48 hours, we have to decrease the BP by less than 95th percentile. This table shows the properties of the drugs which are used orally, and among them, clonidine and minoxidil are used because they are available everywhere, I feel. While the treatment of renal artery stenosis involves two phases of therapy, one is pharmacological, and in pharmacological therapy, first line agent used for unilateral renal artery stenosis with intact contralateral kidney is angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors and angiotensin receptor blockers, followed by beta blockers and calcium channel blockers. एक चीज पे यहाँ पे मैं एम्फेसाइज करना करूंगी कि एक्चुअली ये मिसकंसेप्शन होता है कि मिसकंसेप्शन है कि रीनल आर्टरी स्टीनोसिस में हमें एसी इनहिबिटर्स नहीं देने. इवन जब हम लोग भी थे तो हमें भी ये होता था कि ये नहीं देना. अब जब हम अब ये है मतलब हम व्हेन वी हैव लर्न दैट एंड जनरल पीस में यही था कि नहीं देना है. लेकिन अगर आपका जो कंट्रा इंडिकेशन है वो है जब बायलेटरल रीनल आर्टरी स्टीनोसिस और स्टीनोसिस अगर सॉलिटरी किडनी में हो. अदरवाइज एसी इनहिबिटर्स फर्स्ट लाइन चूज की जाती है, उसके बाद बीटा ब्लॉकर्स एंड कैल्शियम चैनल ब्लॉकर्स. द अदर वन इज रीवैस्कुलराइजेशन व्हिच कंप्राइजेस ऑफ द परक्यूटेनियस ट्रांसल्यूमिनल रीनल एंजियोप्लास्टी एंड अदर इज द ओपन सर्जरी. एंड द इंडिकेशंस ऑफ ओपन सर्जरी आर प्रीवियसली इनइफेक्टिव एंजियोप्लास्टी, एंड ऑर्गन डैमेज, mid aortic syndrome associated with widespread disease, long segment stenosis more than 10 mm, and multiple stenotic areas and aneurysm. In this picture, we can see one picture prior to revascularization where renal artery patency is compromised, and the other one where patency is established through the revascularization. Let's summarize the renal vascular hypertension, which is mediated through the renin angiotensin system, and renal artery stenosis is diagnosed diagnosed through ultrasound Doppler and CT MR angiography, but the confirmatory diagnosis digital subtraction angiography. Its management consists of pharmacological therapy and the revascularization. Now moving forward to our third case, a 12-year-old boy is admitted with episodic sweating, palpitation, and headache. After extensive workup, he is diagnosed with pheochromocytoma. On examination, you find him tachycardic and hypertensive. Pediatric surgical team is on board for tumor resection. Here we will be discussing investigations required for the diagnosing pheochromocytoma. Investigation of pheochromocytoma including biochemical testing, which comprises of plasma and urinary metanephrines and norepinephrines and urine vinyl mandelic acid. Once catecholamine excess is confirmed by biochemical testing, the imaging is performed, which includes CT, MRI, and different methods of nuclear medicines like MIBG and PET scan. Our next question is how you will manage his blood pressure. This slide shows the stepwise management of a child with pheochromocytoma. Step 1 is initiated with the alpha blocker, where we have to give phenoxybenzamine drug before surgery, and where we have to increase the fluid, salt and fluid to prevent from hypotension. Blood pressure monitoring should be done at home and clinic. And here we have to maintain target blood pressure below 95th percentile, and we have to ensure expansion of blood volume. And the second step is the addition of beta blocker atenolol or propranolol and after alpha blocker, which is done 3 days before surgery. Here the target is to, Here the target is to control heart rate. And step 3 is all about during surgery, where fluids, vasopressor, or esmolol, nitroprusside are used to avoid blood pressure fluctuations and tachyarrhythmias. तो इसकी मैनेजमेंट को तीन फेसेस में डिवाइड किया है. फेस नंबर 1, जो हमें स्टार्ट करना है 10 टू 14 डेज प्रायर टू सर्जरी, जिसपे हमें अल्फा ब्लॉकर देना है, और हमारा टारगेट गोल क्या होता है, हमें ब्लड प्रेशर 95th परसेंटाइल से कम रखना है. जो सेकंड स्टेप है, उसमें हम 3 days prior to surgery beta blockers दे रहे हैं ताकि हम अपने heart rate को control कर सकें. And while during surgery जो है हमें inotropes, fluids देने और esmolol or nitroprusside just to avoid from blood pressure fluctuations and tachyarrhythmias. And summarizing case number 3, investigations required for pheochromocytoma or biochemical and imaging. But before going to this child presented with the typical triad of diaphoresis, palpitation, and headache. So we have to keep this in our mind whenever any patient came to us with the symptoms of sweating, palpitation, and headache. So we should keep in our mind the diagnosis of pheochromocytoma. And the management of blood pressure is done through alpha and beta blockers. Approaching toward the last case of today's presentation, which is case number 4, a 9-month-old boy with family history suggestive of autosomal dominant trait is found to have severe hypertension. His serum potassium level is 3.1 MEQ per liter, and both plasma aldosterone level and plasma renin levels are low. You are suspecting monogenic hypertension in this child. Here we will be discussing the pathophysiology behind the monogenic hypertension. The volume expansion in monogenic or Mendelian forms of hypertension are caused by 3 distinct mechanisms. Number 1 is the excessive sodium ion absorption by hyperactive channels, hyperstimulation of mineralocorticoid receptors due to alteration in steroid synthesis, and excess mineralocorticoid synthesis causing volume expansion. And now I will discuss about the pathophysiology. This picture shows the mechanism of different types of monogenic hypertension. This is the luminal side, where this is the sodium chloride co-transporter channel, and this is the ENaC channel. In case of Liddle syndrome, there is gain of function mutation in the ENaC channel, resulting in the increased absorption of sodium. WNK kinase 1 normally inhibit WNK kinase 2, which inhibit the sodium chloride co-transporter activity. And in case of Gordon syndrome, there is gain of function mutation in WNK1, leading to the loss of function mutation in WNK kinase 4 and increase the activity of sodium chloride co-transporter, leading to the increased absorption of sodium and water and leading to hypertension. In case of apparent mineralocorticoid excess, there is deficiency of 11 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase type 2, which normally breaks down the cortisol into the cortisone. But in its absence, the cortisol does not break down to its inactive product, and it will bind to the mineralocorticoid receptor and shows the signs of mineralocorticoid excess. In case of glucocorticoid remediable aldosteronism, there is excessive synthesis of aldosterone from the adrenal gland and will bind to the, and then this aldosterone bind to the mineralocorticoid receptor and shows the sign of mineralocorticoid excess. एक्चुअली इसको सिंप्लीफाई करेंगे, ये जो है दो चैनल्स हैं जो ईनेक हैं और सोडियम क्लोराइड को ट्रांसपोर्टर जो कि ल्यूमिनल साइट पे होते हैं. नॉर्मली ईनेक क्या करता है कि सोडियम की रिजॉर्प्शन करवा देता है और इसमें होता क्या है कि आपका जो लिडिल है उसमें इसकी गेन ऑफ फंक्शन म्यूटेशन हो जाती है, तो वो एक्सेसिव सोडियम की रिजॉर्प्शन हो जाती है और फिर जाके आपका हाइपरटेंशन होता है. इन गोडान में क्या होता है कि गेन ऑफ फंक्शन हो रही है म्यूटेशन WNK काइनेज की और लॉस ऑफ फंक्शन म्यूटेशन हो रही है WNK की, तो जो आपका इनहिबिशन वाला पाथवे है वो खत्म हो रहा है, तो क्या हो रहा है, इंक्रीज एक्सप्रेशन हो रही है सोडियम क्लोराइड को ट्रांसपोर्टर से, तो ज्यादा एब्जॉर्प्शन हो रही है सोडियम और वाटर की. इन अपेरेंट मिनरलोकार्टिकल एक्सिस में नॉर्मली जो कार्टिसोल है वो इनएक्टिवेट हो जाता है कार्टिसोल में बाय द एंजाइम 11 बीटा हाइड्रोक्सीस्टेरॉइड डीहाइड्रोजनेज टाइप 2. बट इन एम ई एंजाइम की डेफिशिएंसी की वजह से कार्टिसोल इंडक्टिव फॉर्म में नहीं कन्वर्ट होता, तो जो कार्टिसोल है इसके हाई बाइंडिंग एफिनिटी होती है मिनरलोकार्टिकल रिसेप्टर के लिए. वंस वो मिनरलोकार्टिकल रिसेप्टर से साथ बाइंड होगा तो ईनए की और NaCl सोडियम क्लोराइड को ट्रांसपोर्ट एक्टिविटी को बढ़ा देगा. एंड GRA में एक्टोपिक अल्डोस्टेरोन की एक्सेस सीक्रेशन होती है थ्रू एड्रिनल ग्लैंड, एंड एड्रिनल ग्लैंड से जो अल्डोस्टेरोन रिलीज हो रहा है फिर वो मिनरलोकार्टिकोइड के साथ बाइंड होगा और सारे साइन सिम्टम्स वो देगा जो कि मिनरलोकार्टिकोइड के एक्सेस वाला होगा. नाउ वी विल डिस्कस द मैनेजमेंट ऑफ मोनोजेनिक हाइपरटेंशन अकॉर्डिंग टू इट्स एटियोलॉजी. All the conditions mentioned in this table are associated with the low renin level. Liddle, Gordan, glucocorticoid remediable aldosteronism have dominant pattern of inheritance with normal inheritors, and they are treated with ENaC antagonist, thiazide diuretics, and mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist, ENaC antagonist, and dexamethasone in case of GRA. And both apparent mineralocorticoid excess and congenital adrenal hyperplasia has autosomal recessive mode of inheritance with low aldo, but AME is managed by a mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist and the ENaC antagonist, while hydrocortisone, mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist and calcium channel blockers are used for congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Now, how to approach a child with the monogenic hypertension? This algorithm shows when to suspect in a patient for monogenic hypertension. These are the factors directing towards a suspicion of the monogenic hypertension, which includes family history of early onset stroke or resistant hypertension, hyperkalemia, metabolic acidosis or alkalosis, abnormal history or physical examination like polyuria, growth failure, muscle weakness, and exclusion of renovascular, renal, parenchymal, and exogenous causes. In subsequent case, renin and aldosterone are done and which exhibit low renin. Now, if low renin and high potassium are, then it is good. No? And with normal or low potassium, then check aldosterone renin ratio. And if the ratio is low or normal, then the following disorders should be suspected. And if aldosterone to renin ratio is more than 10 for pediatrics, then it is familial hyperaldosteronism type 4. Let's summarize our last case. The pathophysiology behind the monogenic hypertension are salt and water retention, and the management includes ENaC blockers, mineralocorticoid receptor blockers, and in some cases dexamethasone and hydrocortisone. And we have approached, we have discussed the approach, how to proceed in a child with monogenic hypertension. Her take home message is that we should emphasize to adopt APCPG guidelines in our clinical setting. As already discussed, we should use new categories, percentile charts, and follow up recommendations. Acute severe hypertension is most commonly due to secondary causes, which should be thoroughly evaluated and managed. And the important thing is to follow the timeline for blood pressure reduction to avoid the complications. And most of our audience is general practitioner in whatever setting they are working. Whenever you encounter a child with hypertension, a proper and timely reflux is important. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sabita. Very well explained. Now, shall we take the questions?
Yes, please.
ठीक है, the house is open for questions. You can put them in chat box or unmute one by one and ask questions.
किसी को कोई सवाल नहीं पूछना? That's amazing.
Ma'am, there is one question. No, there are questions in the chat box. Ma'am, the first question is a drug of choice in hypertensive emergency.
As I've already mentioned, there isn't any preference of any specific drug. And I have already mentioned whichever is available, we commonly use an R setup labetalol.
Okay, I hope that answers. Ma'am, then next is, why does umbilical catheterization cause renal vein thrombosis?
अगर मैं उसके आई थिंक मुझे एक्चुअली एग्जैक्ट पैथोफिजियोलॉजी इसके बिहाइंड याद नहीं है एंड आई विल सर्च एंड विल गिव यू आंसर
ओके थैंक यू मैम देयर इज अनदर वन मैम दे वांट यू टू रिपीट द टारगेट ब्लड प्रेशर कंट्रोल स्लाइड
या श्योर एग्जैक्टली हमें एक्चुअली जो हाइपरटेंस इमरजेंसी अर्जेंसी हो हमें एक्चुअली जो हमारा हमारा टारगेट है वो 95th परसेंटाइल पे आना है और वो जो 95th परसेंटाइल पे हमें आना है वो विद इन 48 आवर्स में आना है तो हमारे पास जो ब्लड प्रेशर है हम उसका पहले 95th परसेंटाइल निकालें कि कितना हो रहा है फिर उसका जितना हमारा टारगेटेड है मतलब हमारे टारगेट जो है उसका जो हमने 95th पे लाने के लिए आना है लाइक इस हमारे केस में था तो उसका 25% जो है वो हमें फर्स्ट 6 आवर्स में कलेक्ट करना है मतलब करेक्ट करना है और जो रिमेनिंग वाला है वो हमें 48 आवर्स में कलेक्ट करना है तो मतलब स्लोली और ग्रेजुअली हमें जो है वो ब्लड प्रेशर को कंट्रोल करना है इन 48 आवर्स एंड आफ्टर डेट आवर टारगेट इज टू रिड्यूस ब्लड प्रेशर बियॉन्ड लेस देन 90th परसेंटाइल आफ्टर 48 आवर्स
Okay, ma'am. Dr. Priya is asking, is labetalol the drug of choice in every hypertensive emergency, irrespective of the cause, like in CKD2?
Actually, आपको कुछ चीजों के लिए देखना है क्योंकि आप एस्थमा में contraindicated और renal cardiac failure में. Otherwise, तो अगर yes, labetalol can be used. अपार्ट फ्रॉम मतलब इन चीज़ों को छोड़ के हम यूज़ कर सकते हैं, यस, बट दिस इज नॉट द फर्स्ट लाइन थेरापी यू कैन से.
Okay. So Rubab is asking, in case of hypertensive emergency, if in 6 hours the BP is lowered more than the target, like more than it is lower beyond 25%, then what to do?
एक्चुअली हमारा टारगेट है कि हमें स्लो करेक्ट करना है, पर अगर हम रैपिड करेक्ट कर रहे हैं और हमें साइंस मिल रहे हैं जैसे टिश्यू हाइपोपरफ्यूजन के, लाइक अगर हमें न्यूरोलॉजिकल स्टेटस हमारा डिटोरिएट हो रहा है और जो है सीजर्स हो रहे हैं, तो फिर हम इस सारे सेटअप में हमें उसको फ्यूज देने और इवन आइनोटॉप्स भी शुरू करने, क्योंकि हमारा जो टारगेट हमें वही अचीव करना है, हमें रैपिड रिडक्शन नहीं करनी है. इन डेट केस हमें आईवी फ्लूइड्स दे सकते हैं, आइनोटॉप्स स्टार्ट कर सकते हैं.
ठीक है मैम. एंड देयर इज व्हाई हाइड्रोलिजिन इज नॉट रिकमेंडेड इन हाइपरटेंसिव इमरजेंसी.
व्हाई हाइड्रोलिजिन इज रिकमेंडेड बिकॉज इट इज आईवी ड्रग, वी कैन यूज इट, बट मसला क्या है कि उसकी हाफ लाइफ बहुत छोटी है, बहुत छोटी. अदरवाइज वी कैन यूज, इन केस अगर आपके पास लेबेटोलॉल कंट्रा इंडिकेटेड, आपके पास सोडियम नाइट्रोक्लोराइड अवेलेबल नहीं है, देन वी कैन यूज हाइड्रोलिजिन इन इन हाइपरटेंसिव इमरजेंसी.
All right. I have one question. Charts, blood pressure charts, the ones that you showed and in Harriet Lane, they all start from 1 year onwards. So, but for the neonates and from like for that age group, what should we use?
Actually, there are different charts for the neonates and infants. And like the there are different charts at first year of life, there are different charts for the post conceptual 44 weeks, there are different charts, and there are different charts or matlab jo ke available hain, even in the internet you can search and find these charts.
Okay ma'am. Okay, there is one more question. First, they are praising that the task, slides were very well explained. The question is, in case of target organ damage, for example, hypertensive and CAF, we have to manage fits first or hypertension?
आप उसको सीजर्स को तो कंट्रोल करेंगे, अगर कोई सीज करता रहेगा तो क्या हमें सीजर्स कंट्रोल नहीं करने हैं? हमें सीजर्स तो कंट्रोल करने हैं, साथ में ब्लड प्रेशर भी कंट्रोल करेंगे. मतलब कोई सीज करता रहेगा, मैं टारगेट करूंगी मुझे ब्लड प्रेशर कम करना है, तो लेकिन आपको सीजर्स के लिए तो एंटी एपिलेप्टिक देनी होगी ना, तो वी हैव टू डू दैट.
राइट. When to switch to oral in case of hypertensive emergency?
As I have mentioned के आपने 48 hours में आपका target achieve हो गया, then you can switch or to oral therapy. अगर 48 hours के बाद आपने अपना appropriate target achieve कर लिया है और फिर आप बच्चे को oral antihypertensive switch कर सकते हैं, and then shift to the pediatric wards, मतलब intensive से out होके आप ward main ward में shift कर सकते हैं. After 48 hours, after achieving the target blood pressure. There is answer of your question. Renal vein thrombosis is a mechanical complication of umbilical catheterization. Thrombus from the umbilical vein goes to the renal vein. Thank you, Dr. Madhya, for your answer.
And then 48
are. Why 48 are cut off? Actually, क्या होता है कि
रेमन रिकॉर्ड वाला
Sorry for the interruption. I've muted. Yes,
actually, हमें gradually और slowly correct करना है. अगर हम rapid correction करेंगे तो मैंने बताया था कि हमें complications, क्योंकि जो आपकी auto regulation होती है, जो cerebral वाली है, मतलब उसको थोड़ा सा time लगता है. ठीक है, लेकिन हमें ये भी नहीं करना है कि हमें बहुत रैपिड करेक्ट करना है. अगर हम बहुत रैपिड करेक्ट कर लेंगे तो हमारे कॉम्प्लिकेशंस हो जाएंगे. दैट इज द पॉइंट, हमें कट ऑफ 48 आवर्स करने हैं. वंस द चाइल्ड इज रीवैस्कुलराइज्ड देन कैन वी स्टॉप ऑल हाइपरटेंशंस? अगर ब्लड प्रेशर कंट्रोल हो गया तो यस, वी कैन स्टॉप इन केस ऑफ रीनल आर्टरी स्टेनोसिस.
So, are there no more questions? I think we are done.
Okay.
So if there are no more questions, we will conclude it. Thank you very much, ma'am. There are a lot of phrases in the chat box. It was very, very well explained. So we will end with this session.
Okay. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you, ma'am. And thank you everyone for joining in.